Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpender Singh and we are going to start with our daily current affairs. So today you have 6th of February 2021 and we are going to cover your current affairs, daily current affairs. So here we are basically bringing for you the day-to-day current affairs, day-to-day news that will be useful for your various government competitive examinations like civil services examination, which is basically conducted by UPSC. Okay, simultaneously you have other government competitive examinations also, which also require you to answer the current affairs questions. So you can refer our future IAS channel where you will be provided the daily current affairs. All right, and we are basically referring the two national newspapers here. The first is The Hindu and the second is Indian Express. Okay, both of these newspapers are equally good. You can read any of these newspaper. Okay, I am following basically The Hindu one. You can refer The Indian Express also. Both of these are equally good. All right, so let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so first is Square Kilometer Array Observatory that is called SKAO project. Okay, so that is basically a collaboration project for the construction of the world largest radio telescope. Okay, so here the formation or the construction of the world largest radio telescope project has given its formal shape, okay, by the constitution of Intergovernmental Council. Okay, so that Intergovernmental Council would look after the construction related, the formation related, world largest radio telescope. So that will have basically, some sort of a collaboration from the world. That means you will have the different countries as a stakeholders in this Intergovernmental Council that will look after, right, for the world largest radio telescope. Okay, that Square Kilometer Array Observatory, that is nothing but a largest telescope, would be spanning two continents. Okay, so that will be spanning around two continents because it's the largest or a square kilometer, or that means its area basically covered by such observatory basically is a square kilometer. So that will be spanning, right, two continents altogether. And that will have the participation of around 20 countries. So 20 countries participate, right, in a Square Kilometer Array Observatory, that is the telescope or radio telescope. And that involved the participation of around 20 countries, right? And it is estimated that the observation would be taken, right, from such observatory by the end of this decade. That means it will take time. It will take time to finish, but it is expected to ready by the end of this decade. Okay, the goal for this radio telescope is basically to study the universe, how the universe is formed, what is the mechanism behind the evolution of the universe. Okay, any sort of a questions which are not answered or which require further elucidation would be studied through this radio telescope, right? The origin and the evolution of the cosmic magnetism, which is very important for understanding the evolution. So it will also study the cosmic magnetism, also the dark energy, dark matter, and the evolution of galaxies in the universe, right? So it will be studying, right, this all domains, right? The building of such radio telescope will be done in the two phases. Okay, it will take around 1.8 billion euros for the phase one. Okay, and that will be planned over next 10 years. So as I told you that it will be done in the two phases. In the phase one, it will be planned over the next 10 years and it require basically the estimation of around 1.8 billion euro that will be spent over the formation of the Square Kilometer, the radio telescope. So it is one such, the pictorial depiction of such radio telescopes. All right. Next is Denmark Artificial Energy Island Project. So you must understand that Denmark is basically a part of Europe, right? And you must understand that the Denmark is, one of the countries which are, lesser dependency on the fossil fuels, right? The Denmark government recently is planning to build an artificial island, okay, in the North Sea. And that island will be giving a push to the green energy. That means here the green energy is something which is non-polluted in the nature, okay, which is non-polluted in the nature. So here the artificial island will be constructed or would be, built in the North Sea for the generation of offshore form energy, right? So here the offshore wind farms will be set up, right? And the surrounding area of that artificial island, and that basically used for the generation of an electricity. And that electricity would definitely be a green energy, because ultimately you are, you know, utilizing the, you know, the winds or offshore winds, which are basically running in the North Sea, right? And that will basically capture the energy, and that will be distributed within the Greenland as well as to the neighboring countries. Okay. So this project, right, is the largest construction project to be undertaken in the Denmark history, right? With an estimated cost of the Denmark 210 billion, you know, currency. As it is also known as Energy Island, because it will be based on some platform, right? That will basically serve as a hub of energy, because it will ultimately, you know, draw the energy from the offshore wind farms. You might have heard about this offshore wind farms also, right? From the offshore wind farms, which will be located surrounding to this artificial island. Okay. The island will basically generate the energy from that wind farms, and ultimately that energy will be used for various purposes. Okay. This artificial island will be located around 80 kilometers into the North Sea. Okay. And the majority of this island would be owned by, you know, again, Denmark government or Danish government. As I told you, that primary purpose of such energy island or artificial island is to provide the offshore wind power, ultimately the green energy, right, which is also, you know, offshore wind power. And the idea of, you know, construction or building of such an artificial island or an energy island, right, to ultimately to connect and distribute the power, that means the power which is generated from the green source or green energy, right, between the Denmark and the neighboring countries. Obviously, it will also help in the alleviation of, or, you know, the environmental changes that is occurring because of anthropogenic, you know, interference. So that will obviously, you know, safeguard our environment also, our climate change also. And that will be, you know, also useful in terms of the controlling of the average temperature, which is basically growing day by day. Okay. And this move of the construction of this artificial island or the energy island is announced after the European Union basically announced its plan to transform its energy system, right, to the renewable basis, right, within the decade. So that means the energy system will be, you know, transformed into the renewable basis within the decade, and to increase the offshore wind energy capacity by over 25 fold by the year of 2015. So the European Union basically is, you know, trying to get that offshore wind energy capacity by over 25 fold by the year of 2050. All right. So here you can see basically the Denmark, where 50 kilometers into the North Sea, there will be, you know, the energy island will be located over there. All right. Next, Proud Boys. Okay. These are basically, you know, the US far rightist group, right, which are associated with the former president of USA, Donald Trump. So these Proud Boys, or these gang of Proud Boys, basically, you know, is basically more far rightist group, or it is a fascist group, or all male neo-fascist group, which is basically formed, right, in the Canada. So what happens is the Canada announced, right, that the Proud Boys, that is the gang, or the US-based far-right group that is called Proud Boys, will be declared as a terrorist entity. So in the Canada, the Proud Boys will be declared as a terrorist entity. Okay. This attempt of declaring this Proud Boys as a gang, as a terrorist activity, is to crack down on the ideological motivated violent extremism, because these are basically, you know, ideologically motivated, that are driven by to make America great again, and to have certain set of the fascism in their ideology, right? So here, this group basically consisting of all male, right, neo-fascist group, and it will be added in the list of international terrorist organization within the Canada, right? That also include international, you know, ISIS, Al-Qaeda, as well as Al-Shabaab, which are also declared as a, you know, the terrorist organizations. Okay. The all-male neo-fascist group, which are founded in 2016, right? It was founded in 2016 by a media, you know, Vice Media co-founder, as well as the Canadian British right-wing activist Gavin MacInnes. So both of them basically formed this neo-fascist group. And these neo fascist group, as I told you, that they are ideologically driven. So they are known for their anti-Muslim rhetoric. They are also known for their misogynistic rhetoric. So which is also, you know, not good for any develop, for any country in terms of the peaceful, in terms of, you know, the safety of the citizens also, right? It is also, this group is also known for anti-transgender views, anti-immigration views, anti-Semitic views, right? So you can understand how dangerous are these groups, right? They are fanning, right, the rhetoric which is anti-Muslim, misogynistic, anti-transgender, anti-immigration, anti-Semitic, which is not good for any country, right? So here, the members are usually having the Make Great America Great Again caps, so which is red colored. So all of these members will be wearing a uniform. That uniform will have the red caps, okay? The caps will be written as, or in the cap, there will be written the Make America Great Again, right? Which is basically taken from the Trump 2016 presidential campaign, right? And these people basically also wear either black or the yellow polo shirts, right? So they will be wearing the black polo shirts, and it will be having the red cap where it will be written as the Make America Great Again. It is basically taken from the inspiration from the Donald Trump's 2016 presidential campaign. Okay, so you can see basically the people, these are basically, you know, standing, they are basically the members of the Proud Boys, right, which are also, you know, neo fascist group which are active in the USA and the Canada also. Canada recently declared them, right, as a terrorist entity. Okay, next, the Rohini Commission. The Rohini Commission, first of all, you must understand, was set up by the Union government. Okay, so here what happens is the commission was set up in the backdrop of the subcategorization of the other backward caste classes, right? So here, you know, to examine whether subcategorization of the other backward caste or other backward classes can be done or not, right? A commission was set up. This commission is headed by Justice G. Rohini, who is basically the former Chief Justice of Delhi High Court. Okay, and this commission is supposed to submit it, you know, the report, but the tenure for such commission have now been extended by the Union government, right? It is now given the tenure until July 31st this year, 2021, right? Until July 31st, 2021, the Rohini Commission must submit its report based on, you know, whether it is feasible to subclassify or subcategorize other backward classes or not. Okay. So as of now, you know that OBCs basically, or other backward classes, constitute around 27% of the reservation at the central level, right? Which is basically given in the jobs and the educational institutions under the central government, right? There is some other, you know, criteria in terms of the reservation which is provided to the other backward classes, right? This percentage vary from the state to state. I'm talking in terms of the central government, or at the central level, 27% reservation is given to the other backward classes, okay? And in the September last year, what happens is the Constitution Bench of the Supreme Court basically, right, reopened the legal debate regarding the subcategorization of the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe also, right? There is, the Supreme Court debated that, the subcategorization of the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe can be also done in that manner, right? So here the debate basically arises out of the perception that only few affluent communities are basically garnering the benefit of this reservation. Okay, so only few communities among 2600, you know, central list of OBCs, right, a few basically securing majority of 27% of the reservation. Other communities are not getting benefited out of this 27% reservation. Okay, now the argument for this categorization, or this, you know, examining this categorization, is based on whether we can create the categories within category. That means whether you can create some categories within OBCs for the reservation, okay? And that will basically, you know, ensure the equitable distribution, right, for all opportunities regarding jobs and the employment, right, among all the OBCs community, okay? The Rohini Commission was basically constituted on October 2, 2017. All right, fine. Next, governmental securities. So here you must understand, the Reserve Bank of India, right, Reserve Bank of India said that it will give the small investors the direct access to the government securities trading platform, right? So government basically issues the, you know, securities from the time to time. Okay, these securities are issued in order to, you know, raise the money from the market, right? So now the Reserve Bank of India has decided to basically to invite or to give the small investors the stake, right, or direct access in the governmental securities on the trading platform itself. So here the retail investors or the small investors can directly open their account with the RBI, or they open their gilt account with the RBI. Okay, these retail investors can directly trade in the governmental securities, all right? And right, and RBI governor recently termed this, you know, this basically, you know, step as a major structural reform in the governmental securities. So until now, the retail investors are not directly participating, but now the retail investors can directly trade with the governmental securities. Okay, the governmental security, which is also known as G-Secs, are basically debt instruments. As I told you, they are debt instrument, right? The government basically raises the money, right? Or government basically borrow the money, right, from the market through issuing these debt instrument, which are also known as governmental securities. Okay. Now, these governmental securities are basically classified into two categories. The first is called basically treasury bills. The treasury bills are nothing but they are also debt instrument, but they are short-term debt instrument. Okay. They are short-term. Their tenure is short. So these short-term instrument, they can mature in 91 days, 182 days, and 364 days, right? So these are basically, again, three types: 91 days, 182 days, and 364 days. They can be, or they are generally mature. And then you have the dated security. They are, again, debt instrument, right? But they are long-term debt instrument, okay? So their maturity period is varying, right? From 5 years, and it will vary up to 40 years, right? So the maturity period is from 5 years to the 40 years, but the short term debt instrument, which are also known as treasury bills, their maturity period is 91 days, 182 days, and 364 days. That means maximum 1 year is the maturity period for the treasury bill, but for the dated security, it starts from 5 years to 40 years. Okay. Next, MK3rd advanced light helicopters. Okay. So first of all, the MK3rd advanced light helicopters basically built indigenously by the Hindustan Aeronautics Limited, okay, which is a PSU, right? Now, the three such MK3rd advanced light helicopters, which is made in India by the advanced, you know, by the, you know, the Hindustan Aeronautics Limited, has handed over these three helicopters to the Indian Navy, right? So here, these handed over of these three MK3rd advanced light helicopters to the Indian Navy would definitely enhance the coastal security apparatus in the coastal region. Okay. Now, these advanced version or these naval version of advanced light helicopters, which is fitted with some sort of a advanced sensors. Okay. These sensors can detect any sort of a, you know, terror related activities like Mumbai terror attacks, right, where the intruders basically uses the waters or the sea to enter into the Mumbai, right? So here, these, you know, advanced sensors will basically detect such intrusion into the Indian landmass. Okay, and these helicopters have latest generation avionics. Okay, so the latest technology have been used here that will have the indigenous low frequency Duncan sonar. Okay, and that will have full glass cockpit, right, which can obviously enhance the view, right? And that will have the integrated architecture display system, and that will have the powerful Shakti engines inbuilt in the helicopter. Okay, and this helicopter is having a nose mounted surveillance radar. I will show you the picture. So it will be having the nose, right? So it will be a nose mounted surveillance radar with 270 degree coverage, right? So it will have enhanced coverage regarding any sort of a, you know, threat in the coastal region, and that can also track the multiple marine targets. Okay, and it will have the synthetic aperture radar and inverse synthetic aperture radars that can also detect targets on the sea. Okay, so you can see basically the nose mounted surveillance radar is basically situated over there, full glass cockpit, and it is basically the advanced lighter helicopter of the naval version, which has been handed over to Indian Navy recently by the Hindustan Aeronautics Limited. Okay. Next, Indian Bahrain Joint Working Group on the Renewable Energy. Okay. So Bahrain is basically a Gulf country. Okay, so you must understand that, you know, the joint working group was set up between India and Bahrain. First meeting of the joint working group, right, in the field of renewable energy have been taken place recently, okay, on the virtual platform, on the virtual platform between India and the Kingdom of Bahrain, right? So here, you know, the following of the taking off of this joint working group, their meeting is basically because of a MOU was signed between India and Bahrain in 2018, okay, regarding promotion of bilateral cooperation in the field of renewable energy, okay, in the field of renewable energy. Say you have the solar power, you have wind power, right, all are comes under the renewable energy. So a MOU was based on formation of this virtual or formation of this joint working group on the renewable energy, and this meeting was held on the virtual platform. Okay, both of the sides mean the India and the Bahrain, both have decided to have the deeper engagement in terms of the bilateral cooperation in the renewable energy, right? So both sides will work on the capacity building, right, that will enhance the cooperation between, you know, the concerned agencies between India and the Bahrain, including the private sectors of the two countries, right? And it will be useful in terms of the generation of the renewable energy, say solar, wind, and the clean hydrogen energy. Okay, as I told you that Bahrain is basically a kingdom or a sovereign state in the Persian Gulf region. Okay, and this is basically the Bahrain is basically, you know, a island region or island nation which is having small archipelagos, which is, you know, made up of 40 natural islands. Okay, apart from that, it is also having 51 artificial islands. So you have 40 natural islands and 51 artificial islands, right, consisting of around 83% of the country's landmass. Okay, so these are basically islands which consisting of the, you know, the island nation, which is also known as Bahrain. And the island nation is basically situated between the Qatari Peninsula, right, and the northeastern coast of Saudi Arabia, right? These, you know, these two places basically joined together by 25 kilometers King Fahd Causeway. The capital of the Bahrain is basically Manama, which is also the largest city of Bahrain, right? So you can see the Qatar here, and you have basically the Bahrain, which is basically Manama is the largest and the capital city also. Okay, next, guidelines for the floating structure. Floating structure, you know, that it can be easily, you know, used as a platform where you can basically, you know, transport something, you can move, you can pass any sort of water bodies, right? So you have some certain set of floating pontoons, right, or the platforms on the water, right, where you can basically use for various purposes, right? So here the Ministry of Ports, Shipping and the Waterways has issued recently guidelines for such floating structures. Okay, these guidelines will have the vision of setting up of world largest floating infrastructure in our country. Okay, all along the coastlines in the upcoming projects. Okay, so that means these guidelines will definitely help in the formation of such floating structures in the coastal region, right? Especially in the upcoming projects, right? These guidelines will have certain set of technical aspects of implementation of floating jetties or floating platforms for marinas, for mining harbors, for fishing harbors, for fishing landing centers, right, for water drones, right, and such other similar coastal areas that may include the estuaries, waterways, rivers, and the reservoirs. So that means such floating jetties and the platforms would be built up or would be constructed, right? And these guidelines provide the technical aspect of implementation of such floating jetties and the platforms. Okay, and these guidelines can be used, right, for construction of such floating, you know, pontoons or platforms in the various waterborne systems, right? And that may be used for example, for your mining harbors as well as your fish landing facilities that can have other utility, and also in terms of the defense, in terms of coastal security also. Okay, the significance of this such floating, you know, pontoons is basically very high, right? That will have inherent advantage, right? Floating structure, obviously you have inherent advantage because you will have ready solution for anything. okay, and that is basically promoted by the Ministry of Ports. So these floating jetties or the structure, right, that will have added advantage in terms of the cost effectiveness. It will be cheaper, it will be definitely cheaper compared to your, you know, concrete structure. If you make such jetties, right, with the concrete, that will be much costlier, right? And the renovation of the jetties is also much costlier, and you cannot basically, you know, change their orientation once they have constructed. But these floating jetties or floating structures, they are cost effective, right? They can be fastly implemented within minutes or within hours. You can implement the floating structure, you can expand them very easily, but the concrete structure, you cannot expand them. It requires substantial amount of the construction related activities. You can relocate them, right, these floating structures, but you cannot relocate your concrete related, you know, structures, because they are very heavy, right? You cannot simply relocate them. Okay, and definitely the floating jetties will have the minimum environmental impact, but unlike in the concrete structure, you have the environmental, you know, some negative impacts also, right? Because you use basically cement and you will have certain set of, you know, the pollution in the area, right? So that will have, you know, that will also minimize the environmental impact, that will also minimize the, you know, the negative impact in the coastal environment also. Okay, so that will have the huge impact. Okay, next, the light utility helicopters. So here, the light utility helicopters basically given the initial operational clearance. Okay, the initial operational clearance is given by, you know, the Center for Military Airworthiness and the certification, right, for the Indian Army. So this center is basically authorized to give the operational clearance regarding any, you know, helicopter or the fighter jet, right, which can be, you know, fly in the Indian domain. So this light utility helicopter have been given this operational clearance, and that will be used for the Indian Army. Okay, the light utility helicopter, it is basically a 3-ton class new generation single engine helicopter. Okay, it is the class name which the helicopter belongs. So it is a single engine helicopter which is indigenously designed and developed by the Rotary Wing Research and the Design Centers of Hindustan Aeronautics Limited. So HAL basically is a PSU which designed and developed this single engine helicopter, which is known as light utility helicopters, right? And that will have certain added features which are suitable for, you know, various operations or various diverse operating conditions which are unique to India. So that is most important. Okay, and why this light utility helicopters have been built, right? That will basically ultimately replace the Cheetah and the Chetak helicopters, which are aging, which are very old. So you need the replacement of Cheetah and the Chetak helicopters, right, which will be replaced by the light utility helicopters. And the light utility helicopters basically is, you know, used the single turbo shaft engine, which is basically known as the RDDEN-1U, which is basically manufactured by the MS Safran helicopter engine, France, right? This will have the adequate power margins, which can basically used in any sort of a high altitude missions, even in the Himalayan region also. Okay, and this light utility helicopter will have the state of art, you know, the cockpit display system. Okay, that will have the glass cockpit, and you will have the state of art, you know, health and uses monitoring system within the cockpit. And it is basically designed for various utility and various armed roles for the Indian military. All right. So you can see basically it is a light utility helicopter which will be used for the Indian Army. Okay. Next, Zamtara. Zamtara is nothing but a literary movement. Okay. Zamtara, you must understand, the Zamtara is basically a district in the Jharkhand state. It is a district in the Jharkhand state. So which is the Zamtara is known for the library movement which was started. Okay. So this library movement was started in the Zamtara district of the Jharkhand, right? Has given recently a news because of certain set of other, you know, fishing capital or fishing activities are going or originating from the Zamtara. So you have cyber related crimes which are originating from the Zamtara district of the Jharkhand, right? Because of that, the Zamtara is in the news today. So here, the district, which is a short district or small district, have 45 functional public libraries. So it is first known for the library movement. So the library, you know, construction or library building has started. Various governmental unused buildings have been converted into the libraries. They have been renovated and converted into the library. But now what is happening is this Jamtara, which is a district in the Jharkhand region. Now, the Jamtara is basically also, you know, infamous, or it is also notorious for the fishing capital of India. Fishing capital means you have various set of the security related breaches, cyber threats, cyber attacks, right? That is originated from the Jamtara district of Jharkhand, right? So here what happens is many youths which are residing in this Jamtara, they are dropouts of 15 to 35 years of the age. They are basically converting into cyber criminals. That means a cyber crime is rampant in the Jamtara districts, okay, which are basically, you know, promoted by these youths, and they basically take some amount of money, right, in terms of, you know, providing any sort of, you know, the cyber crime related activities within, you know, the Jamtara region as well as throughout the India. Okay, now the police personnel from 22 out of 28 Indian states that visited this tiny district of the Jamtara, right, for any sort of a fraudsters or cyber fraudsters, right, they said that majority of the online fraud basically calls is originated from the Jamtara district. Okay, so this district is, that is why it is known as the fishing capital of the India, because almost the majority of the fraud calls basically originated from this Jamtara district, right? Even the Netflix 2020 crime data shows the Jamtara as one of such, you know, the cyber crime, and as many as 93 cyber criminals are basically behind the jails in the Jamtara jail, right? And you have 156 online fraudsters, right, which were arrested, you know, in the 72 different cases in 2020. So you can understand the cyber criminal activities is very rampant in the Jamtara district, right? That is why it is known as the fishing capital of India. Okay, and here you have, you know, the understanding in terms of, you know, originating of fraud calls to the India region, right? So here it is also, you know, very dangerous for the normal public also. All right, so that's all for the today. We'll meet again tomorrow for our next news. Till then, thank you very much for attending this class. Thank you.